My name is Daniel Harder. I'm a research civil engineer at ERDC, and today I'd like to talk about bridges during World War II. It's of particular interest because we're coming up on the anniversary of D-Day, and so we like to remember some of the important operations that took place during that war. But bridges have been important during warfare since the start of warfare thousands of years ago. But during World War II, there was a number of really interesting operations when it comes to river crossings and bridges that I think are just of particular interest. So the first bridge I want to talk about is Pegasus Bridge, and that was actually part of the D-Day operation. As the Allied forces came into Normandy, one of the things they had to ensure didn't happen is that Germans could send reinforcements to reinforce those positions. And so the night before D-Day, as the airborne operations were taking place across northern France, a British glider unit came outside of Caen, France, to seize control of the Pegasus Bridge and prevent German reinforcements from coming in. Back then, airborne consisted of both parachute regiments and glider regiments. So they were able to glide in very quietly, land very close to the bridge, and quickly seize control of the structure. At the time, it wasn't called the Pegasus Bridge. It was just a small, almost unnamed bridge across the Caen Canal outside of town. But it was so important that when it was seized by the Pegasus Airborne Unit from the British Airborne Infantry, it was later renamed the Pegasus Bridge in their honor. Operation Market Garden took place after D-Day, and that was an operation to try to seize control of a large area of the Netherlands in order to gain a path into northern Germany, into really the industrial heartland of Germany. And so part of Operation Market Garden was to seize control of 9 bridges across 9 different water obstacles that would result in them crossing the Rhine River into the heart of Germany. While Allied forces were successful in securing a number of them, they weren't able to secure some of the last bridges, and ultimately that wasn't our route into Germany. It's really easy to focus on the structure itself when we talk about crossing a river. How strong is this bridge? Where can this bridge be placed? But really, the planning factors that go into a gap crossing are just as important. How can we get to that bridge? What's the supporting road network and infrastructure to get there? What are the down and upstream flood control structures that may impact water? What's the overland mobility look like? And it's really interesting to see how that played out during Operation Market Garden and limiting yourself to the road network there in the Netherlands, and how that ties into some of the work ERDC does now with supporting gap crossings and the planning of crossing those rivers. How can we get there? How can we ensure there's access to the bridge? How can we ensure that structure is strong enough? After Operation Market Garden, it was not successful to get into Germany and cross the Rhine. We had to take another approach. And so we took a more southerly route through the Ardennes. And you may have heard of the Battle of the Bulge, where Patton had to go in there and get the 101st out. But from there, they were able to cross into Germany and over the Rhine. And there's really 2 major operations and crossing points. The first was a seized bridge in Remagen. You'll often hear about the first across the Rhine or seizing the bridge at Remagen, really a famous operation because most of the bridges across the Rhine River had already been destroyed by the Germans in order to prevent assault across. But for whatever reason, that bridge hadn't been destroyed. And so Allied forces were able to seize control of it, get a number of divisions across to the far side and establish a bridgehead. Now, several days later, the bridge did finally collapse, and we had to go on and construct another bridge across the Rhine. And so Operation Plunder outside Wesel, Germany, was an operation to cross over that bridge by building a pontoon bridge. It was a massive operation, taking tens of thousands of soldiers, thousands of vehicles transporting bridge equipment, and 9,000 engineers constructing the bridge. But ultimately, we were successfully able to cross the Rhine and get into Germany. There's just no substitute for a bridge when it comes to getting large masses of forces across a water obstacle. There's ferries, there's amphibious vehicles, there's low water crossing sites, but none of them can get the number of vehicles across the river as quickly as a bridge. And when we're talking about moving armies, there's just no substitute for a bridge. ERDC does a lot of work about bridges in a number of areas. We have teams that help assess bridges on military installations around the world to ensure they're safe for operation. We have teams that work with our forces overseas to assess civilian infrastructure and understand if they're going to be able to handle military equipment in the event of a war. We have people that study the effects of standard bridges, which are like pre-made bridges, and how they're going to behave in the environment, how they work in water that's flowing quickly, or how will they be able to move around the battlefield, how they'll behave under different dynamic conditions. We have folks looking at the bridge inventory and figuring out how we can effectively use those to best manage those resources. Really just a lot of things across all of our labs looking at bridges and supporting gap crossings.